Morning, everybody. So good to get to join together today again to worship our God. So why don't we stand to our feet and we just bring our heart to you, God. We're so thankful for all that you've done and all that you will do. We bless you, Jesus.
You see my victory. When all I see is a mountain, God, you see the mountain. And as I walk through the shadows, your love surrounds me. So when I fight on my knees with my hands lifted high. Oh God, the battle belongs to you, and every fear I lay at your feet. I'll sing through the night. Oh God, the battle belongs to you.
Still
fight on my knees, my hands lifted high. Oh God, the battle belongs to you. Every fear I lay at your feet, and I'll sing through the night. Oh God, the battle belongs to you. We give you our battles. An almighty fortress, you go before us. Nothing can stand against the power of our God. You shine in the shadows. Nothing, nothing, nothing. Sing almighty, an almighty fortress.
You go before us. Nothing can stand against the power of our God. You win every battle. Nothing can stand against the power of our God.
Almighty fortress.
Our God is an almighty fortress.
You shine in the shadows. You win every battle. Nothing can stand against the power of our God. An almighty fortress.
Yeah.
You go before us. Can stand against the power of all.
You shine in the shadows.
You win every battle.
And nothing can stand against the power of our God.
Almighty
can stand against the power of our God. So when I fight, I'll fight on my knees. So give it over. So give it over.
Yeah, Jesus, we just thank you so much. You have gone before us. Nothing can stand against you. Yeah, we just give you our troubles, God. All our fears. We have a compassionate high priest. Thank you, Jesus.
To my rescue, and I wanna be with you. wanna be where you are. 'Cause I know that this is where I'm
from. Yeah, this is a song of invitation this morning, a song of grace. The Bible says that all who calls on the name of the Lord shall be saved. And so we just get to come in this loving response to this God who has poured out his love for us. And our posture is simply to respond. Yeah. You know, the word says, I called and you answered, but it was he that first called us. And we answer him. Yeah. And our response is simply, I just want to be where you are. So if you're here this morning and there's any part of you that is still holding back, or if you're watching online this morning and you're not sure about how good God is, let me just encourage you this morning just to step in, just to respond, to hear the Father calling your name, calling you to him, yeah, and respond to him this morning. It's as simply as stepping in with our whole heart of surrender. Hey, there's grace here this morning to do that. So you're invited to step into his love, into the Father's love today.
Let's just take a moment. Why don't we close our eyes? Just step into that word, that invitation. We thank you, Jesus. We come to rest in you.
Yeah, I think as well, like, our identity is found where he is. Like, so often we tend to get our identity from, like, what work we do, like, what instrument we play, like, what we do in the Sunday morning, or whatever. But, like, our identity is with him. Like, it doesn't matter if you pick up the garbage or whatever. Like, it doesn't matter because your identity comes from him. Like, what he says about us is so much more important than what other people say about us. No. Like, if your identity comes from the things that we do, then we will be, like, moved around every single day. We'll be moved around, like, yeah, tossed around like waves of the sea. But the moment when our identity is in us, like, we can switch the jobs, we can switch occupations, we can switch whatever, but, like, it doesn't change who we are. Because God has told us who we truly are. So, yeah, I just want us to just take a moment and just really let God say and define who we are.
Fear
'Twas grace.
'Twas grace that taught my heart to feel.
Yeah.
And grace, it's all 'cause your grace. And how precious deep that grace is.
The Lord has promised.
The Lord has promised good to me. His word, my hope, secures. He will my shield and portion be as long as life.
See my chains,
my chains are gone. I've been set free. My God, my Savior, has ransomed me. Like a flood, His mercy reigns unending. Your unending love. The earth shall soon dissolve like snow. The sun forbid to shine. The God who called me.
My chains are gone. I've been set free. It's scriptural, isn't it? Our chains are gone. But so often, we think our chains are gone, and then all of a sudden, we find that we're bound up again. And I remember one morning, I was sitting down here worshiping, and I'd let go of a lot of things, and I felt really free. But then I'd let some stuff back in. I'd let some fear back in, and I was sitting there, and I was feeling bound up. And I said to the Holy Spirit, "You said my chains are broken." And he said, "They are, but you've got to let them go." So often we hold those chains like they're a security blanket, and we still feel bound up in them, but they're actually broken. We just have to let them go. So this morning, can I just encourage you to let your chains go? They're broken. Drop them to the ground. You are free.
The word says to set your eyes on things above, not on the things of the earth. He also says, as we behold him, we become like him. You have been made complete. It is finished. Sometimes it doesn't seem like it. Sometimes it doesn't make sense. But we trust and we hold to Jesus. So this next verse we're going to sing, when we've been there 10,000 years, it builds hope in my heart that this isn't just for nothing. We stand in eternity right now.
We've been there 10,000 years.
Come on, let's sing it like we mean it.
Listen, we've no less days to sing your praise.
Let's sing it again. Let's just sing Amazing Grace.
Amazing Grace, how sweet, that saved a wretch like me. I once was lost, but now
I'm found. Thank you, Jesus. Gave your blood for us. How sweet and how precious you are, Jesus.
Just like to share a scripture of encouragement and thanks. Out of Psalm 138, it says, I give you thanks, O Lord, with all my heart. I will sing your praises before the gods. I will bow before your holy temple as I worship. I praise your name for your unfailing love and faithfulness, for your promises are backed by all the honor of your name. As soon as I pray, you answer me. You encourage me by giving me strength. every king in all the earth will thank you, Lord, for all of them will hear your words. Yes, they will sing about the Lord's ways, for the glory of the Lord is very great. Though the Lord is great, he cares for the humble, but he keeps his distance from the proud. Though I am surrounded by troubles, you will protect me from the anger of my enemies. You reach out your hand and the power of your right hand saves me. The Lord will work out his plans for my life. For your faithful love, O Lord, endures forever. Don't abandon me, for you made me.
Go before I know that you've even gone to win my home. You come back with the head of my enemy. You come back and you call it my victory. Oh, King Jesus.
Just wanted to encourage some of us today that our King is a beautiful, gentle King who waits with us. There's so many people in this room that are waiting for those promises, and I just sense that in that song in the very beginning, it's the being with Him in the waiting. It's the being able to lay our head on His chest and just be with Him when it's hard, and it is. And then, you know, we had this word about our identity being in who He says we are. And I just wanted to encourage those of us who are waiting for family members, also for family members who have spoken against us, that it's hard not to listen to family who we love and adore. But Lord, the Lord wants us to know that He is the one that we can recline onto, that we can be held by, and that His words to us are what He wants us to hear above our children, above our spouses or ex-spouses, that He wants to be the one that can whisper, "I'm here waiting with you." And it was such a gift to me, because as I was hearing this, one of the members of our church walked in today with a miracle that they'd had to wait for and pray for. And I just thought, I just need to encourage you that the waiting time can be painful, but He's holding us in that huge disappointment. And that it's okay to be disappointed, because you can just rest on Him and He's okay with that. But also that, you know, Job didn't know the end of his story. We know it because we read the whole thing. But he got to see his grandchildren and his great-grand, his lineage, and that God has got it. And it doesn't look like it, it doesn't feel like it, but He's there holding you. And just wanted you to be encouraged that He's with you on this hard journey.
You give life, you alone, you bring light to the darkness. You give hope, you restore every heart that is broken. Great. You restore every heart.
bones will sing, great are you, Lord.
Yeah, let's lift our voices.
Minister to the Lord.
And all the
earth will shout your praise. Hearts will cry, these bones will sing.
Great are you, Lord. And all the earth will shout. Oh, we lift a shout.
Just in these last few moments, I just feel the spirit of breakthrough is here. Jesus is here. You don't have to hold on to your chains. They're not yours anyway. He took them and he bore the penalty. Let's just take a moment. Let's just prophesy. Pray for our family members, our friends who don't know him. What a joy it is to know you. What hope there is to know that we spend eternity with you. Why would we want to keep that in, Jesus? Spirit of prophecy, flow through us today. We give you way. We yield to you today. Just thank you for opportunities, Lord. Thank you for opportunities to speak your word and to sow life. To sow life into this world.
Yes. Therefore, God also has exalted him, that's Jesus, and given him a name which is above every other name, that at the name of Jesus every knee should bow, of those in heaven, and of those on earth, and of those under the earth, and that every tongue should confess that Jesus Christ is Lord, to the glory of God the Father. So Jesus, we thank you, and we thank you now for the places that you want us to prophesy, for the places that you want us to pray, for the things that you want to fill our mouth with, to speak out, to declare, and to ask you to bow the knees that are not bowed. And Lord, if that's starting with us, then let it start with us. Because you know, there's parts of you that are in complete agreement with Jesus being the Lord, and there's parts of you that are still on the journey, right? And when, you know, you sing the reprise for the 14th time and you start to switch off, that's just when you've hit the part inside of you that doesn't agree that he is Lord. And the first 13 repeats, when you are really in it, they're the parts that really agree that he's Lord. And they're happy celebrating. But when you hit that spot where you switch off, that's when you found that part inside of you that's not totally surrendered there yet. It's still coming along. And that's the part where you get the choice to just press in and say, hey, heart, you want to come along and just join in with the rest of me there? Jesus really is King. Hey heart, would you like to bow your knee to the King of Kings and the Lord of Lords? Yeah. But as Josh was saying, there's two things that might be happening for you, but you might be in a place where you're like, actually, I've got someone that I want to speak over right now in the Holy Spirit and declare that Jesus would come and help them bow their knee and would help them be surrendered, whether it's in heaven, whether it's on the earth, or whether it's under the earth. So can I invite you to pray, to speak to those places, to speak to those places that you're battling for, fighting for, asking for, and invite Jesus to do all of the hard battle, because the victory is his, yeah.
So musicians, if you could go over that refrain again, if that's all right, and just as the music builds, invite you to step into that place, okay? This is time just for a few more short moments this morning. Prophesy, pray for those family members, for those neighbors, for those work colleagues, for those classmates, for those kids, for those elderly people. Begin to intercede for them, yeah? Let's pray. Would you stand to your feet, church? Thank you. If I could just gently challenge you beyond your comfort zone right now, yeah? This is a moment, and we don't just turn away from this moment and get on with the program, okay? This is a moment that the Lord has led us to right now, to prophesy and to pray over these lives. And so just begin to open your mouth, begin to bring them to the Lord. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Jesus. Shout your praise, our hearts will cry,
Great are you, Lord, overcomer, overcomer.
You've overcome. By the blood, the word of our testimony.
Father, we bless you, we praise you, we adore you. We bless the teens as they head out right now into their time of learning and teaching, building community. I just feel right now, I know we've got a Mission Sunday this morning, so I'm going to ask everyone to be seated, except if you're here for Mission Sunday. Because we want to, obviously we're all here for Mission Sunday, but we've got some visitors here especially. But even if you're part of the house and you're here for Mission Sunday, that's okay. You can still stand. I'm very clear, aren't I? We just want to prophesy and declare God's goodness over all of our mission workers. That's you, Morag. Yep. So just reach out your hands to these folk. Lord God, we thank you that you are a sending God, that you are a missional God, that you love people so much, that you've loved us so much, that you sent someone to us to share the good news with us, that we were able to respond to your call. And Lord God, with what you began in us, Lord, we bless those who are going, those who take that call, those who go to carry your love, Father, and to carry your word into our community and overseas. Father God, we bless the work. We bless our chappies in the room right now and those involved with chaplaincy. And we thank you, Lord. I just pray that you'd fill these guys with the love of the Father. Jesus, just fill them, Lord God, as they go into those school communities. For our RI workers, Lord God, and the administrators, Lord Jesus, for everyone involved in teaching religious instruction in the schools, we bless them as they go and love on those kids in Jesus' name as they share your word, Father God. We bless the crew, the Chapmans from Vanuatu and their friends, Lord Jesus. We thank you. We get to hear some news of that this morning. Lord, we bless Sharon and Glennis and Evie and Susan, the mission team, and Morag with Roaring Hope. Lord God, we just thank you for that ministry, that unique ministry of sharing the word of God, the love of Jesus online. Lord, just bless Morag. May her team just be expanded, Lord God, with good people, Lord Jesus, people who are ready to share your love. And Father, we thank you for Tim Daniels, Lord Jesus, for building strong families, the work in Thailand, and for Jason. We're going to hear from Jason today as well, that work in Thailand. Father God, for the nations of Southeast Asia, we pray, Lord, increasingly your kingdom would come. Lord God, for Thailand, for Myanmar, Father God, for Cambodia, for Vietnam, for all that region, Indonesia, Lord God, our neighbor, we pray, Holy Spirit, would you just come and move in those lands, Father, we pray, in increasing ways, so that more and more disciples would be made, that your church would be strengthened, Lord God, that your witness would be carried along in this earth, Father. Father, we thank you and we bless you in Jesus' name. Yeah, amen. I'm sorry if I missed any of those groups out, but we bless you. Today is Mission Sunday. We've got booklets there, so you'll be able to read a lot more of the missions that we as a church support and partner with. And I'm going to... Thanks, team. So good. I don't know about you. Worship felt a little bit hard this morning. Yeah. Okay, it wasn't just me. But I just had this picture. You know, when worship gets hard, I always respond to the Father's invitation. You know, worship is about coming into the Father's presence. And if worship ever seems hard to you, just step into his presence. It's like our Father has, you know, he's got his living room there and he's there waiting for us. And we can just step in, all right, in ease because of what Jesus has paid for us. So if worship ever gets hard and you're distracted by stuff, can I encourage you, just put the distractions aside and step into the Father's presence and just be. Yeah. And we just thank you for all those words, for that obedience, guys, as we broke through there at the end. It's good. I'm going to invite Shani and Andy. I think you guys are going to come and share some news from your recent trip to Vanuatu. And following these guys, I'm going to invite Sharon, our missions coordinator, to come up and just kind of steer the ship from then on. Thank you. Yeah. So welcome them.
Good morning, Ogeta.
Good morning, everyone.
Praise the Master.
Praise God.
We stopped long Vanuatu, long time finished now, yeah. Is that cedar? No, I thought it was cedar. All right, I just want to say a little quick one. Good fella notes blow me, he stopped long desk blow me, long house now, yeah.
He left his notes behind.
Anyway. So we spent a month back in our beautiful, beloved Vanuatu. I left my notes at home. Here's a quick rundown. Amazing things. We were able to baptize our beautiful daughter, Vivi. Man, that was special. Other things. while we were there, we redid our little house that Vivi's been looking after. There's a leaf house that was full of white ants, so we ripped all the roof off. And
rats and snakes and centipedes.
Yes. Anyway, we fixed that.
2.5 years of non-maintenance.
And next up, it was a wild trip. We reconnected with lots of friends and family. We delivered Owen's drums down to Tanner. Thank you, Owen. And they're a blessing to a church family down there that Vivi knows. And then it was crazy. Our ICC pastor, we did a multicultural day. So we sang Land Down Under, of course.
And our food was Vegemite sandwiches that we took.
So amongst the Fijians, Samoans, Ni Vanuatu, everyone, like, it's an amazing church, Chinese, everyone. And that was our last service for our Canadian pastor. Because on Thursday, he went to be with the Lord. So we had a far out. We had his funeral service the next Sunday. He said, like only a month before or a week before, he said, I'm invested in this country. I will live in this country. I will die in my bed. I will die in Vanuatu and I'll be buried in Port Vila. And that's exactly what happened. And it all happened while we were there. So, yeah. Is that not the heart of a missionary? That they're willing to give up their lives and just everything? Everyone should have been standing when Stu asked the missionaries to stand. Everyone's got a ministry. Everyone has a mission. Your ministry is what God has given you in your hand. Your gifts and talents. Your mission is the people God calls you to. Whether that's a Nambour primary or whether that's the homeless in the streets of Nambour or the kids in school here. Or whether that's another country far, far away that we can't pronounce or can't understand. That's where, that is every believer's call, is to represent him. So really quick, amazing stuff we went to. After that, we went to Tongawa. The road was closed to Gawa that they were expecting us to come in north, like Bush Island in North Vanuatu. And so the road opened to us to go to Gawa. So we went on a ship, that was crazy. Shani, I'll tell you in a second. And then as soon as I got there, I thought, I'm going to be bold. So they had a Presbyterian gathering and 2 weeks of evangelism and stuff. It was really exciting. And so I just started praying for people. There was a guy with all drinking coconuts. How mad am I after coconuts, man? And so I thought, no, I'm not going to ask for one. I'm going to pray for him because I see he's got a sore ankle. He had it wrapped up. So we prayed for him. He got healed. He gave me a coconut. Oh, man, I thought, well, this is going good. And I turn around. There's a lady there holding her belly like this, and she's in anguish and in pain. I said, what's happening? She said, Belblo mi sor Tomas, like basketball me, like her womb. I said, oh, my gosh, I've never prayed for this before. So I said, put your hand on your stomach. I put my hand over the top and we prayed together. Next day, she's healed. Wow. Lady that we're staying with, we haven't been there for 10 years. We were supposed to deliver Bislama Bibles. They never came.
They came a week later after we left.
On the next ship.
We sponsored 120 Bislama Bibles that went from that island to another island. It was really great what happened.
So we just kept praying for people. There was a lady sick with fever in our house that we're staying in, just one island bush house. And she was like, she was bent over like this in pain and crying and stuff. And we're going, oh God, have mercy. Next day she's up, just praising God and running around. We couldn't believe we're asking them, did God really heal you? Yes. And then we ask their friends, you know, woman here, Amy Gammon, or you tell them it's true? Yeah. Yes, she's telling the truth. So praise God, God does amazing stuff. We haven't got a healing ministry. He does. Anyway, Mr. Roy, long time to Mas. So here's Shadi with an account of our boat trip.
Before the boat trip, you forgot the really important thing. So 3 years ago, 3 years ago, we did a music school. We took over drum kits, sound systems, keyboards, guitars, which is still in a container in Vanuatu. When we went over, we thought, is this the end? Like, COVID sort of spoiled everything and we came back and everything stayed there. Anyway, before we did go 3 years ago, we did a music school. Georgia was there and we did songwriting, music, drums, dancing, all sorts. And that was the only time we did it and the only time we used all those instruments that are still there. Then when we went to this island, unbeknownst to us, they had this two-week evangelism school. And one of the guys at the school said, you're the guys, you're the ones who taught us back then 3 years ago. You're the ones. Since then, we're using that 1 week that we did. They've multiplied that much bigger and better. They're doing 2 weeks of evangelism training. They're training up the local people and going out to other islands. And we just stood back and went, wow. So, you know, normally I feel like we're kind of the sowers or the waterers. We don't really ever often get to see the end bit. But God allowed us to see the harvest of all that sowing and all that hard work. And it was really amazing. From that evangelism school, they had the Holy Spirit came this one particular evening. People were flat out on the floor. I said to my friend, have you ever seen this sort of stuff before? And they're like, no. I said, that's the Holy Spirit. He's working. And then they brought tribes together who had had unforgiveness from ancestors before, who this one murdered that one and blood that was shed on the land. And they called a reconciliation from the family line of that guy to the family line of that guy and had this reconciliation. Andy and I just, bystanders, we were just going, look at what God's doing. We're doing nothing. We're just here. But he allowed us to see huge reconciliation. And we know that when the land is blessed then, that blood is washed away and the blood of Jesus blesses. And so we got to see the blessing of that. I did want to tell you a funny story, though, because it's not all like that in Vanuatu. We were trying to get to this island and the only way we could get there was by a ship because the airlines are going bust and so we couldn't get there, so we had to go on a ship. So my friend said, oh, go on the ship. I said, does the ship have seats? He goes, oh, you can sit on cartons and bags of rice and things. I'm like, okay, so there's no seats. It's a 10-hour trip. Are there toilets? He said, Yeah, you got toilet. You don't want to go to that toilet. Not on that ship. So anyway, it was a 10-hour flight. We left at 3 in the afternoon.
Boat ride.
Sorry. And then I thought, we can do this because we used to do this when we were young. We can do this. So I took my thermos and my cup of tea and my bickies. Everyone thought we looked ridiculous because, you know, they've just got their little bag. We had mosquito nets and backpacks and all the things. And so anyway, we're sitting there and I was drinking a cup of tea at 5 o'clock and the sun's coming down on the water. I said, Andy, this is really romantic. He's sitting on his, I don't know what you were sitting on.
Something hard and uncomfortable.
Yes. And then it started to become night and they pulled down the tarp and the boat started to rock. Oh. And I'm like, by 11 o'clock at night, I was sitting right beside a 20-kilo bag of onions as my pillow. I said to the guy, get those onions away from me. There's a rotten one in there, and I was green. I was going to throw up, so they got the onions away. So at 2 in the morning, we got to our island. So you get on another boat, which takes you into the sand, and they dropped us there. And we looked ridiculous, because we had all our things. You know, white people carry things. We looked ridiculous. We got off the thing, and it's pitch black at 2 in the morning, and there's nobody there on the beach to meet us. And we're just standing there, and the mountain like that going up to the village is like a 40... He's saying stop. Okay, there was a 40K walk up there. 40K. 40 minute! Anyway, quickly, end the story. A couple of guys helped us get up the hill. We got up there. He said, where do your friends live? I said, I don't know. Haven't been here for 10 years. It's pitch black. I have no idea. So he knew an uncle who went and knocked on his door. He felt like, what's that? Knock, knock on your door in the night, whatever. Anyway, he came out with his torch and said, oh, yeah, we know them. Follow us. So we go past and we finally found our friends and they were like, oh, you're here. Yeah, it's 2 in the morning. You're meant to meet us there. Oh, yeah, no, we were asleep. But so there's some hard things that go on with missions, but we are so thankful that the Lord allowed us to see that. And we have no idea what next, absolutely not. We've got beautiful Vivi staying with us until Christmas. And after that, I lost my job the day I come back. And Andy already lost his job too. So we're like, wow, what is God doing? So anyway, I got to go. So we got to thank you guys. What's this? Therefore, we are ambassadors for Christ, God making us his appeal through us. We implore you on behalf of Christ, be reconciled to God.
Amen straight. God bless.
Thank you.
Vivi Emmy, still single girl, island princess. Oh. Oh, sorry, I embarrassed you too much a little bit.
Love you, Vivi. Good luck. You dropped your flag, right?
Oh, that's so awesome, isn't it? When you get to see God really moving, yeah, and what he can do. It's not by might, it's not by power, but it's by his spirit, hey? Yeah, that's awesome. Okay, we've got a short video from Jason, I believe, in Thailand. Have we got that ready to go, guys? Most of you are aware of Jason in Thailand.
Mission Sunday morning, although we are filming this on Saturday afternoon. Behind the camera there is David Rutch, Jason's dad, and we've been boots on the ground now for 6 days in Khon Kaen, Thailand. And it's just been really interesting to be with Jace. For those of you who don't know, Jason is our homegrown missionary, been on the field now for actually 12 years, isn't it?
13, something like that.
Yeah, and been serving the people of Thailand all that time. So this is my first opportunity of being over here with Jason, and so great to actually be a part of what he's doing and see live what he is actually, who he's connecting with and the work that he's doing over here. So he has set up a foundation called Cascade. And Jace, just explain a little bit about Cascade to people.
So the term comes from, it's an abbreviation for Community Advocacy and Support for Care and Development. And what we do is we support community advocates. So we work with a large network of people who are people who are affected by various injustices. Majority of them in the past have been people living with HIV who can't get access to care due to discrimination and other problems that with modern life that people have difficulties resolving. And we help them to meet their immediate needs if they're in crisis, no food to eat, very sick, that kind of thing. And we also help work with them to train them how to take care of themselves and take care of other people in similar situations. That same model we can use for people who are experiencing homelessness, suffering with addiction, all kinds of different things. So that's why we use the broad term community advocacy, and we just support the community advocates.
Very good. One of the things I witnessed with Jace is that he has begun to, or has over a period of time now, connected with a number of local bands. And it's very interesting, the relationship that's actually developing between Jason and his organization and these secular bands. Jace, do you want to explain a little bit about where you see this going and the purpose of it?
One of the issues that we find working as advocates and working as representatives of people who are on the edges of society, marginalized people, people who are living marginalized are often the kind of people that go to concerts and go to pubs and finding themselves out in the nightlife, both because that's where they find employment, that's how they cope with the stress of daily living. We also find that band members, musicians, artists from a lot of different levels of notoriety or fame have a more innate understanding of the kind of struggles that the marginalized populations have. Rather than working with business owners or government people who tend to benefit from the kind of structures that lead to this marginalization, working with artists, they don't necessarily benefit from other people suffering, but have been in that position before. They've been starving artists, they've been working hard to get there and get to where they are, and every night they're performing amongst the people that we serve. So they already understand what we're doing because they've been there themselves. We don't have to explain it. And they also have access to, Tony said, local bands. They are Thai bands, but they are very, very famous in Thailand. So they have access to, they have amongst their fan clubs, they have millionaires. And they also have our boys, our people living in the slums, who are huge fans of them. So it helps our case retention because they know me as somebody who is in the background of a lot of famous people's photos and can get them into the green room, get them backstage. And that same access gets our foundation and gets the needs of our cases to the people who are making decisions about policy, about money, about all kinds of things. And also gets us to a bunch of employers? Yeah, job creators, all that kind of thing. So that's one of the fun interactions we have that we're working with. Plus it's enjoyable.
So as you can see, Jason is involved in some very creative ways of connecting with the community and also getting his message and his story to the right sectors in the community that have a lot of influence, and the message gets to a lot of people. So yeah, we're so greatly supporting you, Jace. Hope that you really enjoyed this very short interview. But if you'd like more information, you'd like to be on Jason's support team, please go and visit the stand out in the cafe, I'm assuming it's going to be. Sign up to get Jason's newsletter. If it's so is on your heart to do, love you to be praying for him, and also sign up for financially supporting him. So it's Cop and Car from me.
And thank you from me.
Awesome. Jason's been doing an amazing job, and he always responds. Like recently he was responding to all the floods and things over there in the slum areas, and he's just jumps in and does whatever he sees the need. So yeah, like Stu said before, we've got tables set up out in the cafe hall later. You can go around and just check out all the different missionaries that we support. With most of them, we're able to support directly through your tithes and offerings. There's some, however, like Jason, because of the ACNC rules and regulations that the government have brought in to sending money overseas, it's not an easy option to support some of them. So, yeah, if you feel on your heart to give to Jason directly, you can do that, but you'll find information out on the tables and chat to whoever's on the tables about all the different ones. And we've also got an amazing bake sale table and lots of gift ideas and things. So if you didn't come prepared for today's family picnic, hey, we've got you covered. We've got sandwiches, we've got quiches, we've got cakes, we've got all sorts of things. And yes, we have gluten and dairy-free options as well. So no excuse for not staying for the picnic. I'd like to call up Di from Religious Education, or CREP as it's called. Christian Religious Education Program, I think that's right. Yeah, big long name. And share a bit about that. Thanks, Di.
I don't know about you. I get excited whenever I hear anything that's missional. And I loved earlier in the service when we were given that challenge that we actually all are missionaries in our own space and place. And sometimes that's just in our family homes. And sometimes it's further afield. But wherever it is, you know, God has called every one of us to have a footprint of Jesus in that space, and that's a big call on all our lives. And so religious instruction in state schools here in Queensland is one of those, and here on the Sunshine Coast in particular. But I thought I'd give you an idea of just how large this ministry actually is. And it's a cooperative ministry of all of the local Christian churches who gather together to make this work. And FlameTree, thank you. You're one of those and support and committed to it. And we have RI team members here in the service this morning. But we get to do RI because parents want their students to do RI. Isn't that amazing? In our society that's constantly looking away, we still have, across the state, at this moment, 200,000 students whose parents have consented them to be involved in RI. 200,000 students. And you can be assured a lot of those parents are not necessarily associated with the church or have any affinity with the Christian faith, and yet they want their students, their children, their young people to be involved in RI. Here on the Sunshine Coast, we have approximately 10,000 students who are consented into RI here on the Sunshine Coast alone. And that's supported by around 500 volunteers from local churches who believe in reaching the next generation for the kingdom. And it's just a wonderful opportunity. And I always say this, that if we think about our local communities and we think about a landscape in our local communities where the footprint of Jesus needs to be, because that's the footprint of the community, it's the local school. Because children, young people, their parents, their grandparents, their extended family all traverse that school ground at some point. What an amazing reach for Jesus. And so that's what we do. But I need to let you know that we're not in every school. All those consented students, we're not reaching them all yet. And so we need more volunteers, I have to say. We need more volunteers. And we just even need somebody who's willing to go in with another RI instructor and just help them. That's an amazing task to be fulfilled. But then we also need RI instructors, because I don't know about you, but I don't want any of the next generation to miss knowing who Jesus is. And so that's our call for those of us who are involved in it. But you know what? I would like to just put a challenge to each of you, not just for RI ministry, but for all of the missions of this church. You can all pray for a mission every day. And that gift is amazing. Because I can tell you with absolute assurance, there are some schools we didn't think we'd ever get in. But by those who prayed for that school and for those students, that door was opened. And we work alongside chaplaincy. We're great buddies with chaplaincy because we're both in the school space. We get the privilege, though, in the classroom. We get to open the Bible and we get to say everything about the faith with those students, which is an amen. So thank you for supporting RI here. Thank you for supporting missions here and abroad. And just remember, every one of us can pray every day for a mission, and that will make a difference. Thanks.
Thank you, Di. That was awesome. So, hand over to you. Sure. Yeah.
Thank you, Sharon. How good a job is Sharon West doing, everybody? So good. Thank you for your coordination, Sharon, and for your team. Yeah, would you grab that? Thanks, Alex. And look, here's the challenge. If you want to know your faith better, teach RI. Seriously, because kids will come out with the questions that are going to like, oh, I'm not sure what I think about that. I'm not sure how to answer that. I've got to dig deeper. All right, so if you want to grow in your faith, teaching RI is an awesome opportunity to do that. Before I went into high school chaplaincy, I taught RI for 3 years. So this is like back in the early 2000s at Nambour Primary. And up until probably, oh, it was probably only like 3 or 4 years ago, I was walking through Coles just here, and there's this young man there in the fruit and veg section, and he comes up to me very kind of sheepishly, and he says, "Do you know who I am?" And I did, because he had a name tag on. But I remembered, I said, "Yes, I do, James." I said, "I taught you RI at Nambour Primary School, didn't I?" And he said, "Yeah, I did." So there's sort of connections that are made that last for years and years and years and years. Never underestimate the power of God. Yeah, the power of a loving, you know, example of Jesus even in a secular environment, like a Queensland classroom. Yeah, because God is greater. And look, with the time that we have left today, I just want to share a few thoughts with you guys just on this subject of mission, because as Andy said, yes, we are all missionaries. We serve a missional God, a God who draws men and women and children into relationship. He's doing it every day, despite what the media says. Despite, you know, the atheists and the agendas that are out there, God is on the throne and he is active and alive, and he is drawing men, women and children into a loving relationship with him through his son each and every day. And he's doing that with or without us, but isn't it awesome when he partners? He invites us in to partner with him. Like Andy and Shani learnt, that they couldn't do all the missionary stuff during COVID. Wasn't COVID a gift? Hands off, step away. And now when we get invited to step back in, wow, God, you've been active still. So good. And I'll just remind you of our friend last week, Caitlin. Whoopsie, you know, wasn't she fun? But she shared with us some thoughts from Philippians, but then also from Acts. She talks about, you know, when Jesus says to the apostles, you know, don't go, just wait here, you know, in Jerusalem, wait until the Holy Spirit is given. And then what? Then you will be my witnesses in Jerusalem and Judea and Samaria and to the ends of the earth. Remember that she shared that with us? And some of us are, you know, we really major on the waiting. We've been told to wait. And sometimes there's a season in our lives where we're called just to wait, just to stop, to listen, to rest, to wait. But for the large part, you know, the Holy Spirit has already been poured out. We have received the Holy Spirit. We're in this age where the Holy Spirit has been given, yeah, and is freely available to all the sons and daughters in Christ, yeah. And so there's no need to wait in that sense, but to be my witnesses, Jesus says. That's in Acts 1, verse 8, and you might have heard this before in a clever little irony. It's not until Acts 8 verse 1 that the disciples actually leave Jerusalem. You know, following the persecution of Stephen, the martyrdom of Stephen, then it says that a persecution breaks out against the church, and all except the apostles were scattered. Where? Throughout Judea and Samaria. And so finally, the church, the mission of God, is on the move. And this morning, that's what I'm sharing with you guys this morning. For lack of a better title, this is called On the Move. And actually, in our pre-service prayer, Calvin prayed that the Spirit of God would be on the move. You use those words, on the move. You know, God is on the move. His Spirit is always advancing. He is on the move in all of our lives, and he invites us to be on the move with him. Yeah. What does Joel always say? The kingdom of God is movemental. Yeah, it's in motion. And so we're called to be on the move. So mission, I believe, is not just something that we contribute to as a church. We do contribute to these missions. It's our goal to give 17.5% of your offerings to outside missions, whether they're local, national, or international. Yeah. That's our commitment. It would be awesome if we could give even more. And we seek not to distinguish between, you know, what is necessarily missional out there, but also how we use our funds in here, because we're actually a missional body ourselves, right? Yeah. And so we keep that as an accountable thing, but it's not just something we contribute to. Mission isn't even something that we do, but mission is something that we are on. We're on the move. And in the book of Acts, following that expansion chapter 8, verse 1, then there's so many different examples of then how the church is expanding in mission. But this morning, I just want to briefly draw your attention to chapter 16. Acts 16, if you've got your Bibles on your phone or on the page, have a look at that. Just want to draw out a couple of things very quickly here this morning. From verse 6, it says, Paul and his companions traveled throughout the region of Phrygia and Galatia, having been kept by the Holy Spirit from preaching the word in the province of Asia. When they came to the border of Mysia, they tried to enter Bithynia, but the Spirit of Jesus would not allow them to. So they passed by Mysia and went down to Troas. Now, imagine that. Okay, Paul is on this is his second missionary journey. Paul is not new to following the promptings of the Holy Spirit, right? He's the Apostle Paul, okay? So you'd think that he would know where God is leading him or how God is leading, okay? He's an experienced traveler in this. He's a mature, not only a believer, but an apostle, for goodness sake. And yet somehow he's thinking, okay, we're going to Bithynia, we're going to Mysia, we're going to this place, but it says the Spirit of Jesus would not allow them to. There was a blockage there. And we're not really entirely sure what that looks like, but there's something, there's an unction in his spirit that says, closed door, no go, all right? And he's obedient to that. But what I want to draw out here is that because these guys were already on the move, they were a vehicle, a vessel that the Holy Spirit could communicate clearly with. It's not that their going manipulates the Holy Spirit to move, but in their going, they provide God a vehicle, a surrendered vehicle or vessel in which to move and which to prompt. Yeah. Now, God can speak to you at any time. God can speak to you at any time. But can I suggest that it's more likely when we're on the move, when we're already walking, when we're already heading in a direction, that we're actually more promptable yet to follow his lead. Yeah. Discipleship's all about next steps in following Jesus. Where's he leading to next? What's he saying? Where's he got you going next? What are the next steps God is calling you to take? So after that, they go down to Mysia and went down to Troas. During the night, Paul had a vision of a man of Macedonia standing and begging him, come over to Macedonia and help us. You know, in that willingness, that ability to hear the Spirit, then a vision is given, a dream is given of a man from Macedonia, come over here. You know, and the invitation from Europe. Up until that point, the gospel's gone around Judea, Samaria. It's getting to the ends of the earth. This is the first inkling where the apostles are actually going to take the gospel, the good news, over to Europe. And so it says here in verse 10, check this language. After Paul had seen the vision, we got ready at once to leave for Macedonia, concluding that God had called us to preach the gospel to him. Emphasis is mine. Do you notice the language there? It goes from Paul and his companions to we concluded. Who's the we? Well, Luke is writing this account of Acts, right? He's the one who wrote the Gospel of Luke. He's putting himself in the story. This is the first inkling that we get in the book of Acts that Luke is actually amongst these travelers. He's not just writing it from over here. You know, a few years later, he's there in the action with them. And so Luke himself goes from a historian to an evangelist. He goes from someone who records the data. He goes from a physician to a missionary. We sailed. We concluded that this is where God is leading us. You know, there's something that drops when our language goes from them speaking about those people doing the mission or those people leading the church or even those people in that church, something drops in our spirit when we go from using that language of them to us, to we. We are on mission, church. We are on the move. This great commission, this command of Jesus, be my witnesses, is not given to a few, it is given to all. And has already been shared, we all have a field of influence, of mission, that we're called to be and bring the good news to. Starts with our family, but it doesn't end there. It goes out from there. Okay, something happens when we own that responsibility, that sense of belonging. How are we going? Okay, still got time. Let's keep reading. From Troas, we put out to sea and sailed straight for Samothrace, and the next day on to Neapolis. From there, we traveled to Philippi, a Roman colony and the leading city of that district of Macedonia. And we stayed there several days. On the Sabbath, we went outside the city gate to the river, where we expected to find a place of prayer. Now, that's an interesting sentence. In cities in the Roman Empire time, if there were more than, I think it's 10 Jewish men, there's likely to be a synagogue. And as was Paul's practice with his companions, they would firstly go to the synagogue to share the good news about Jesus. In Philippi, there's no synagogue. And so when there isn't a synagogue in a region, in a town, the next place where people are likely to be gathering, God-fearing Gentiles as well as Jewish people, is going to be a place of prayer. And as it happens in Philippi, it's down by the river. They expect to find a place of prayer. And here it says, we sat down and began to speak to the women who had gathered there. One of those listening was a woman named Lydia, a dealer in purple cloth from the city of Thyatira, who was a worshipper of God. Now, this Lydia, we don't hear too much about, but it does tell us that the Lord opened her heart to respond to Paul's message. She was a dealer in purple cloth. I kind of picturing, now this isn't in the Word of God, but this is kind of me speaking here. Paul was a tent maker, right? And Lydia's a dealer in purple cloth. I'm just picturing they're kind of breaking the ice and they're talking shop for a little bit there as well. You know, and then God opens up her heart to hear the good news of the kingdom. And she says, if you consider me a believer in the Lord, she said, come and stay at my house. And she persuaded us. Okay. I've missed out there that she and the members of her whole household were baptized. That's pretty important news as well. Okay. So this is the first convert, the first disciple made in Philippi, in this region, in Europe, if you like. And then this chapter of Luke, we're not going to read it all, of Acts, sorry, goes on to tell us two other converts, all right? There was a servant girl who had some sort of supernatural power that was kind of causing her to call out about Paul. And Paul, it says, gets annoyed with her and casts the demon out of her, and she becomes a believer. The guys that are making money off her, they're not too happy about that. And so they have Paul and Silas and Timothy and Luke, we're presuming as well, the four of them, arrested and thrown into prison. You guys know the story, right? They're in the Philippian jail. In the dead of night, they're singing praises. And there's a big earthquake and the shackles come off, the chains are gone, I've been set free. My God, my Savior has rescued me. Maybe they were singing that song. I don't know. And then the jailer is about to do himself in. He's suicidal. And Paul says, no, we're all still here. We haven't gone. Don't do it. And then God gives the jailer grace to respond to the good news. And he and his whole household believe and are baptized. Why am I sharing all this besides the fact that it's in this chapter that God's led us to? Paul finds in these people, Lydia, the servant girl and the jailer, people of peace. We've talked about people of peace before. Luke 10, Jesus sends out the 72, go find the man of peace and stay there. Stay in that household. Eat the food that they give you. Follow these pathways, these doors that open up for you, and be and bring the good news. Paul is following that same pattern. Paul and his companions. Lydia is a person of peace. She serves them. She says, hey, if you consider me a believer, come and stay in my house. She's open to the gospel. The servant girl is set free, and now she's open to the gospel. The jailer who was suicidal has heard the good news. He's seen the evidence of God himself, and now he and his whole household are open to the gospel. Paul's simply on the way. I'm sure when they set out from Troas, they didn't think, now we've got to find a dealer in purple cloth, we've got to find a servant girl, and we've got to find a jailer. That's the key. No. They're just going, following the Spirit's leading, looking for people of peace as they go. Can I encourage you, church, as you go, as you're on the move, look for people of peace. Look for those people who, you know, don't shut the door, first of all, on any conversation. But a person of peace is someone who likes you, someone who listens to you, someone who even serves you in different ways. And there's plenty of them out there. They're all around us. If we go prayerfully expectant, God, would you lead me to the people of peace that you're drawing me to? As we go confident that God is already at work in people's lives, yeah, it's the Spirit of God that does the work, and we just get to step in and partner with him as we do. So these are three unexpected people and their households turning to God. I've got to tell you that in recent months, I've been blown away by the number of conversations, the number of text messages, calls, just connections that have been coming out of the community, of people who know people who God is doing something in their life. Yeah. A friend who knows a friend. And I'm not going to go into specifics or details now, but God is moving. He's drawing the hearts of men, women, and children to himself, and he's looking for a people who will partner with him to be people of peace also to these ones. Let me share you some good news really quickly. I'm going to share you. This is from a study that was done during COVID. It came out, these stats came out at the end of last year. And it's called The Change in Spiritual Climate of Australia. And I can send you the whole study if you want access to that, let me know. But let me just share with you some numbers here very quickly. In Australia today, there are 47% of Australians are thinking more, much more, or even just slightly more about the meaning of life than before COVID. 47%. There are 47% who are open, more open or much more open to spiritual conversations than before COVID. There are 33% of those people, more, much more or slightly more, thinking more about God, just in general. And 28% are praying more. See, despite, you know, the stuff that we hear on the media, despite the, you know, the outcome from the latest census that brings, you know, Christianity or down a peg and people who are attribute to no religion up a peg, this is not a time to freak out. This is actually a time where God is the parameters are changing so that now we can no longer rely on cultural Christianity to get our numbers through. You understand what I mean? People who say, yeah, I'm a Christian because I was christened as an Anglican as a baby. Those people, without an active living faith, those people are now saying, actually, I don't believe. Those who do believe, those who are standing up for Jesus, are the ones who are ticking, yes, I'm a Christian. Yeah. But even for those who now saying, I don't believe, there's generations that are coming through now who maybe haven't had RI, maybe they haven't had Sunday school, maybe they haven't heard the stories of the gospel, but God is still stirring something in them to respond. As the world, you know, globally, financially, environmentally, as everything is kind of going to pot in the world today, as everything that is shaking, that can be shaken, is shaken, people are going, what is left? What can I anchor my hope to? Because the previous things just aren't cutting it anymore. And so God is drawing the hearts of people to him. Listen to this. 2 out of 3 people are likely to attend a church service either online or in person if personally invited by a friend or family member. 1 in 3 people are extremely likely or very likely. 1 in 3 people to attend a church service, either in person or online, if personally invited by a friend. And if you're in a younger generation, so generation Z and Y, it's around half, one in two people are likely to attend, to respond to an invitation to something. 76% of Australians agree that the churches in their area are making a positive difference to their community. Yeah. And so this morning, folks, I just want to build your confidence that God is doing something, that he who began the good work in you will carry it on to completion. And that's from Philippians, which is the church that this place was started, okay? The church that began to meet in Lydia's household. Later on, Paul would write a letter to the Philippians. And again, Caitlin shared a verse with us from Philippians last week. What did she say? For it is God who works in you to will and to act according to his good purpose. It's God who is at work in you to will and to act according to his good purpose. And as he works in us on this Mission Sunday, every day, it should be Mission Sunday, I believe. Because what Jesus has done in us, what Jesus is doing in us, never stops with us. Yeah? As a natural byproduct, it overflows to those around us. Let's pray. Father, we thank you that you are a good and loving and sending God. We thank you, Lord God, that you work with us even in the mix, even as we are still seeing our lives being put back together. We thank you, Lord, you don't wait for us to be a perfect example before you use us, just an authentic one. And so, Lord, we invite you, Holy Spirit, just to move in us, Lord God, just to shape us. Remind us, Father God, of the next steps that you're calling us to take in our following of you and as we influence and call others to follow you too. We pray in Jesus' name. Amen.